don't have any desire to live in the city, because I feel the people that live in rural areas have the advantage over people in the cities. They're closer to nature, they're closer to God, and I think they have a better relationship with one another.
It's spring in Spring Hill, Tennessee. Over at Bill Dodson's farm, there are already three new calves, plus a tiny foal trying its legs for the first time. The hackberry trees down at Rutherford Creek, which for the past few months have pretty much matched the cold gray mood of winter, are getting dressed in a brand new coat of green. It's already starting to get a little warmer, but it's still cold enough so that Mildred Reese, the school bus driver, still likes to start the engine a little early, so the bus will be nice and warm by the time the kids get on. It's spring, once more, in Spring Hill. The time of year when life begins all over again. But at first glance, despite how nice and pretty everything's beginning to look, this spring doesn't seem to be all that much different than any other. Odessa Barnhill's prize-winning azaleas are in full bloom again. Bruce King's touching up the paint on the Grace Episcopal Church. Lucy Lockridge is taking advantage of the sunshine to air out the family quilts. Pretty much the same as any other spring. But there is a difference.
It was on TV in the afternoon on the 6 o'clock news. Tom Brokaw was the one that announced it. And he made the statement that it was in a little town between Holt's Corner, where my husband was raised, and Fly Station.
What is different this spring in Spring Hill made news around the nation, because the events in this tiny town would sooner or later touch the lives of millions of Americans everywhere. And not inconceivably, a good part of the people and a good part of the rest of the world. Because in Spring Hill, Tennessee, they're making a brand new car. But it's not just a brand new car. It's a brand new car being made in a brand new way.
Nothing ever happened here before and of any significance. And people kept thinking, well, is it real? Can it be real? And I kept thinking, no, there's something, it's not going to really happen. And of course, some people were saying, we hope it doesn't happen, because they like the community the way it is. And a lot of people moved here from other places, and they didn't want it to change. So they were hoping it wasn't true. And then the others were hoping it was, because of the potential job market, the progress that would be made. And of course, it's exciting to have something of this nature come to your town.
Down Highway 31 West, about a mile and a half from the center of town, and virtually hidden behind the land where the old Haynes Mansion still stands, one of the largest and most incredible industrial projects in American history is underway. Enough concrete to build 5 miles of freeway. Enough steel to make a half dozen Eiffel Towers. Enough siding to cover the Empire State Building. Over 4 million square feet all told. Well over 5 times the square footage of all the buildings and houses in Spring Hill, all put together.
Right now there are probably 3,500 construction workers involved in the project. And the factories are running, there'll be up to 3,000 people involved in building the product. When we're at full capacity, there could be up to 5,000 people involved in the product. But probably totals 30 million man hours.
All this just to make a new car.
30 million man hours. That better be a pretty good car.
A pretty good car. Yes, it had better be that. And a lot better. Because today, pretty good isn't good enough. Especially for the country that taught the world how to make cars in the first place. It wasn't so long ago, although it may seem like it, that no one in the world could hold a candle to America when it came to cars. We didn't invent the automobile, but we surely invented what it became. In the 1940s, of all the cars built in the world, 4 out of 5 were made in the USA. By 1960, only half were made here. And today, less than 1/4 of the world's cars come from America. There was a time when we knew more about making cars than anyone else, anywhere. Time alone would have changed that. But to make matters worse, we taught the rest of the world everything we knew.
One of the things that happened in our business was that we gave the competition many of the ideas, and especially in the area of technology. And we gave them the basis, if you will, for their part in the auto industry. And then we didn't pay any attention to them. When I was managing plant, I was concerned about how well the guy at Buick was doing. Wasn't even thinking in those years about Honda or Toyota. Well, in the meantime, they're marching around us. Well, how did they do that? What were the things that led them to overtake us, if you will, especially in the small car area?
As we grew, a variety of things set in. You know, the mass production, the assembly lines set in, the different levels of management set in, where they weren't there when companies were created.
Well, really, it was necessary to rethink the whole process because the way we've been doing it has not made us competitive. On a worldwide basis. And we really had to rethink and reanalyze what it was that was a barrier to our being competitive.
In the early 1980s, a decision was made. We were going to build a better American car. However, it had to be done. But the question was, how do you do it? When you already know all there is to know about building a car, how do you learn to begin all over again?
Back in 1982, the idea of putting a group together to determine how we could make a small car and compete on a worldwide basis, it was really germinated. And it began as a small group, and then it grew to a group of what has become known as the 99.
The 99 experience was able to bring together people from literally all walks of life. Top management, and people off the assembly lines.
The group of 99 was to travel more than 2 million miles and spend more than 50,000 hours in Europe, America, and Japan, finding out what had created success in other major companies.
And in a relatively short period of time, after seeing the same things and being in the same places and hearing the answers to the same questions, they all came up with the same answers. They all came up with the same conclusions.
How did we get the technician on the floor, the worker, the people with their hands on the car, how did we get them involved in the business?
They did a study a while back of, they took a bunch of people from an assembly plant and asked them the question of, people, these are people off the line, they asked them a question about, if you were at a cocktail party and somebody asked you what you do for a living, 85% of them would lie about what they did for a living.
A chance to be involved. A chance to make something. A chance to make something better. A chance to be heard, to participate. It was an idea the American automobile worker had been waiting for a long time.
I remember looking at all our furniture on the front lawn as we were packing it and thinking, this is it, you know. And I think another reason I was so afraid is because this is it. You know, this is the move, and it has to work. We had been reading a lot about the concepts, and Ron wanted to do something something that he could be proud of, and he can expand his role here.
To do the job, hundreds of people, and eventually thousands, would leave their homes in other parts of the country to find new homes and new friends and new schools for their children around Spring Hill, Tennessee. Yet, despite the disruption in their lives and careers, there was no shortage of people who wanted to go. It wasn't just the attraction of doing something new. It was the chance to do something that had never been done.
He's real excited about this. This is his it, you know?
There's been times in the past where a group of people have come together and produced a vehicle or some vehicles that were was very obvious that were done by people who love the vehicle. That usually was an accident, or this one was sort of planned.
The way we used to manufacture cars is we'd have management telling us basically, this is the way the car should look and this is how much it should cost. And then you'd have a group of product engineers and a group of designers that would create this car, if you will, throw it over the fence to manufacturing and say, build it. Built it just like I drew it, just like I specified. Then that was always a problem. Nobody talked, and if they did, it was very seldom.
It wasn't just a new car that was being built. Finally, people were getting involved, and a new spirit was being built around Spring Hill.
A healthy argument's when the books start flying a couple of times, and an unhealthy argument's where everyone walks out of the room, everybody says, oh, well, okay, I agree, you know, but in theory, they really don't. What brings the ideas together? The people in the room. It's just the old story, you know. One guy generates ideas, and sometimes he gets locked into one way of thought. But when you get a few people in the room, you know, anything goes. And I mean, literally anything goes. You can hear all sorts of crazy ideas, but within those crazy ideas are some new ways to do things that perhaps you hadn't thought of or never would have, because you're looking at it from only one aspect.
The plant that I came from, I think there was a lot of us and them. There was management, and there was the union folks, okay? Mm-hmm. The way you told the difference, and it was a real, real easy one, of some of them wore ties, or the salary wore ties, and the hourly didn't. They mostly used a person's body from the neck down. They didn't use, you tried to offer input, and it just wasn't there. Oh, well, that's a silly idea. Well, you just worry about putting the pistons in the center supports. Don't worry, we'll run a business. You don't worry about that, we'll run a business. And it's obvious the shape that we've got into today.
New ways of thinking, new attitudes, people who care about what they do. And one of the main reasons they care is that the new plant at Spring Hill allows people to do something that hasn't been done in this country for decades. To make not just the parts of a car, but to build virtually the entire car in one single place.
This whole process is new to me. I worked in the crank and rod department, and that's all I ever saw of an engine was cranks, rods, and sometimes intake manifolds. You never saw a whole car. You built part of an engine, or you built a seat, or you built a door, and it went somewhere else, and somebody else put it together. And those people never saw where those parts came from. They just came in crates, and they took them out of a crate and put them together. I think that's why that we came here and started a whole new plant instead of using an existing facility, is that we could start totally fresh, totally new, and build from the ground up, do it right this time.
To create a new car from scratch, you start from everywhere and nowhere. You look at what has worked for others and what hasn't. You look at why things have worked. And if they haven't, why they haven't. You think of what can be. You think of what might be. While the other cars in the world today are simply evolutions of earlier models, in this case, you don't have the benchmarks and the comfort of evolution. There are no absolute givens, but there are no real guidelines either. Because much of the technology you're putting into this car is only now being developed.
Do you know how many car companies have started from scratch in the last 50 years? Maybe a half a dozen. When this car comes off the assembly line, it will represent everything that we know, everything that we've learned about car engineering and car design since the car was first invented.
Most of everything that has worked in the automotive industry is already running on the roads of America. So to help learn what this new car should be, its planners and designers and engineers spent nearly 4 years driving, judging, writing about, testing, and going to work in the cars they would have to beat.
We have a tremendous young organization, people that work their hearts out day and night, not living by scar tissue of old ideas and things. You know, the amount of competitive information that's known here is far greater than any other program I've ever seen or been in. You know, the people really, really know the competition.
Competitive information. What the other guys are doing. That's a help. But it's only a beginning. Because to be successful, ultimately, this car can't simply be a reflection of what has been done or what is being done. This car must also be a response to the future.
I think what's going to make the auto industry different from what it is now is maybe a couple things. One is competition on a global level. We feel that now. We felt it for 5 or 10 years, but there's going to be more players, I think. So the competition is even going to be fiercer than it is now.
To be sure everything will work, especially new and original technology, you need to test. Not after you've made the car, but before you've made it. So you'll know that when it all comes together, it will work the way it was meant to. Not only on the day the first car is sold, but for years afterwards.
We have over 4 million miles stacked up so far, simulated and actual vehicle mileage. There are a few prototypes around, but not too many people have seen those. What we have been doing is putting a lot of components in other cars, getting a lot of mileage on them. There's probably in the order of 100 cars now running around, both on public and private roads. And in doing that, we gain a lot of valuable experience. We test everything from electrical components to powertrains that way. We basically test the car all over the place. We spend winters in Canada, where it's 40 below. We spend summers in Arizona, where it's 115. We push the car to its extremes, mainly because somewhere out there, somebody else might do that. And especially when you're talking things like the way a vehicle handles, we got to make sure we're bulletproof. We don't want to put something out there in the public's hands that has some surprise. And if we don't push it to its absolute limits and find out where the breaking point is, somebody out there is going to do it for us. And we don't want that to happen.
This is our last chance. We're not going to get another chance. We kind of went to sleep as an industry, and not only automotive, but in all industries in this country. But I think we're going to win the battle. The way we're headed right now, I think we've got it turned around.
There's a true story that goes back to the time when people were first thinking of building a car in Spring Hill. When they were looking at the land, its peacefulness and its beauty, someone noticed a cobweb. And they said, when this plant is finally done, we'd like that cobweb to still be there.
When we first heard this, we thought, you know, it's going to just ruin the scenery and it's going to just be a terrible thing. But now you can drive down 31 and you can hardly see it at all. And so far as we're concerned, it really hadn't hurt our lifestyle that much. We're still farming and we're still surviving.
The plant is there now. And as was hoped and planned, the land has changed very little. But other things have changed a lot. While this new car will be, like any other, a combination of metal and plastic and rubber and glass, this one will be made of much more. It's made of commitment, a belief that what America has done before, we can find a way to do again. It's made of perfection, an insistence that whatever's done, however well it's done, can still be done better. It's made of partnership. A willingness on the part of everyone involved to share in the cost and the future success of doing a better job. And for all the robots and costly machines and complex computers that may help build it, this car is, more than any other, a car that is made by people. By 99 men and women who affirmed once more that good products aren't made by mystery or magic or even machines, but only by people who care. By a union man and his family who were willing to start all over again. It's made by a few special car dealers from Maine to California, who want to see the American car become what it once was and can be again. And it's even made in some small part by a little boy who's had to find new friends at a new school, 1,000 miles from home. It's spring again in Spring Hill, Tennessee. And life somehow seems a little better. Just the fact that it's spring is one reason why. But another is a car that a lot of people have put their lives into for a lot of years. A car to make its makers proud.
Somehow you've got to leverage your resources. You've got to get in there and get, you know, it's, you've got to use the talent that you've got on board. You've got to use people's brains. I feel that since I've come here, we've made some significant, I mean, we've really tore down some of those typical ways of thinking.
I know when we send the engine that's going to go in that first car, I think we're going to walk, follow it right around the corner. And I think we're all going to be standing there. I know it's going to mean a lot to me.
The plant Ron came from, it was very narrow. But they allow you to do what you can do here, and he's real excited about that. And I could see that in here, and I just wanted him to be real proud of what he was doing. And I wanted to show our boys that he could have a job that he was proud of.
It's been a long, cold winter in Spring Hill. One that some people thought would never end. But the sun's out now, and people are feeling good again. They should. They have something to feel good about. It's not just going to be a pretty good car. Thanks to you, it's going to be a damned good car.
Because it's very basic stuff that we're talking about here. Given the proper degree of trust and respect for one another, people will work together toward common goals. I don't care what the situation is.